Thank you for logging on for our virtual worship experience here at the Potter's House International Ministries, located in the bold city of Jacksonville, Florida. And although we have been corporately separated, the church is still alive and well. Families are getting closer, living rooms have become sanctuaries, and your digital devices have become instruments to connect to God. Ministry continues beyond the four walls of the church as we continue to meet the needs of our local community, blessing nearly 1,000 frontliners with free meals through our COVID-19 Relief Fund and feeding hundreds globally through our India Global Missions. Many of you have been blessed and felt the presence of God through our live streams on Facebook, YouTube, and our website, and we still need you to help us reach more. So share this feed now, because our world needs the word like never before. Keep giving, because your gifts help us continue kingdom ministry. Remember, you can give at any time during this virtual service. There's text giving. Just text the word GIVE to 904-601-1695. You can give online at tphim.org or through our Ministry One app, or mailing your gifts to TPHIM at 5119 Normandy Boulevard, Jacksonville, Florida 32205. Now here to welcome you is our pastor and founder, Bishop Vaughn McLaughlin.
Greetings, everybody. Merry Christmas. That's an expression that many people are used today. People are used, right through the end of the new year. I've had people tell me that all week long. Merry Christmas. This is a wonderful day. This is a season to be jolly. We have a reason right now in the middle of this pandemic to have joy. The Bible says that peace on earth, goodwill towards men, that great joy has come to the earth in the person of Jesus Christ. There's nowhere in the scripture that teaches us to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, even though when he was born, men came to worship him and to bring him gifts. So we do know that he came. It's called the incarnation. God came in human flesh. So this special broadcast today is to be a blessing to you, to give you maybe a twist on the Christmas story that you haven't heard, to share with you and to remind you of the Christmas story, but to let you know, especially you who are believers, that we have something to celebrate. We have something to be excited about. We have joy that's really unspeakable, and it's full of glory. Why? Because we beheld his glory as that of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So call somebody now. Let them know that the Potter's House International Ministries is on the air with a special Christmas message, a special Christmas broadcast. Matter of fact, an unusual topic, Christmas, a declaration of war and peace. That's right. Call somebody, text them, share this with somebody, tune in, stay tuned in. It's going to be a good message, I promise you. So tell somebody, the bishop and the Potter's House is on the air with a word from God. See you in a little bit. After this song, we'll be back.
On your knees, Divine, oh, night.
Greetings, everybody. This is Bishop Vaughn McLaughlin, and welcome to this special Christmas morning service. I hope you've enjoyed yourself so far. I really hope that in your homes today, there's grace plenty, that the people of God in your household are rejoicing in the fact that Christ came through 42 generations. He came and was found in a manger, wrapped in swaddling clothing, lived a sinless, impeccable life, grew up, was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. And now he's highly exalted and given a name that's above every name. And at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue must confess. And the cry today is, oh, come, let us adore him. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. There's coming a day when he will reign forever and forever, and we will reign with him forever and forever. What a glorious day when the Lord returns. He came, he lived, he died, was buried, and rose again the third day, seated at the right hand of the Father, and he's coming back again. I can't wait. You know, we don't all have to die. Matter of fact, the Bible said, we shall not all die, we shall not all sleep, is what the scripture says, but we shall be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. That's exactly what Jesus came to do, to make that possible, to make that declaration possible. So I'm going to share with you a topic, a subject today called Christmas, a declaration of war and peace. Christmas, a declaration of war and peace. Father, thank you for this time. I love you. Appreciate you. Bring us together from around the globe to hear this word. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I'm going to read two passages of scripture, one from the Gospel of Luke and the other one from the Gospel of Luke chapter 12, one from the Gospel of Luke chapter 2. 2:11 are verses that you would expect to be heard and be read on Christmas Day. But I want to read them and share with you them in a different light. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be the sign to you. You will find a baby, wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And then in the Gospel of Luke chapter 12, verse 51 through 53. Did you suppose that I came to give peace on earth? Uh-oh. I tell you, not at all, but rather division. For from now on, five in one house will be divided, three against two and two against three. Father will be divided against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against her daughter-in-law. Well, that's the fact. And daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Those verses lead me to share from the topic, Christmas, a declaration of war and peace. Who do you know that uses a text for the Christmas story like Luke chapter 12? I mean, how many times have you heard that one read? It's Jesus saying, do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I came to bring a sword, to bring division. Matthew 10 records his account of this declaration, and he says in Matthew 10:34, do not think, Jesus says, that I came to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Now, these words just don't seem appropriate, right, for this time of year. This is Christmas season. Jesus says, I came to bring a sword, division. Whatever happened to tis the season to be jolly, fa-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. This is that time of year. Well, how about the words to joy to the world, right? The songwriter wrote this song, and he says, joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her king. You know it. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature your sing joy to the world. It sounds like when Christ came, the angelic host glorified God, peace was promised, and joy. I remember learning that song, Joy to the World, when I was in the fifth grade. We sung it actually as a class competition against the sixth graders. I was in Miss Kilpatrick's class, and we sang against Miss Harris's class. We were instructed as we sang to smile, to show, remember the teacher said, the joy of Christmas. We were told that Christmas is the time of year where we sing and are merry because, here's what she said, Santa Claus was going to give us lots of toys. Of course, that is, if we had been good. So she said, you need to sing because toys would be under the tree, which was the reason for the second selection, I believe, because we closed with this second selection, which was entitled, are you ready? Santa Claus is coming to town. And it went, you better watch out, you better not cry, you better not pout. I'm telling you why Santa Claus is coming to town. You remember this? He's making his list. He's checking it twice. He's going to find out who's naughty or nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. And I used to love this part. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. Oh, you better watch out. You know that song. And we sang that. Santa Claus is coming to town. And the charge was to be good. Because if you're good, he will give you gifts. He knows if you've been naughty or nice. So our teachers were sincere. But they had no idea the confusion that they were creating in the hearts and minds of little kids like me. Here lies the confusion. Was the purpose of my joy at Christmas the fact that Santa was coming to bless me or the fact that Jesus came to save me? Was it joy to the world because the Lord had come, or was it, you better watch out, you better not cry? So to this day, people are not sure about the reason for the joy that we should have at this time of year. It is because, watch this, I may get some gift, or is it because I may get some gift from man, or is it because I have received the ultimate gift from God? That's the inquiry, right? That's the reason for some of the joy that we should have right now. For some people, it is because they got gifts from men. For other people, it's because they have the ultimate gift from God in the person of Jesus. In the natural, many people spend the holiday season more depressed than anything. Lord have mercy. Some get in a funk because of a lack of attention in comparison to what they see others getting, the attention that boyfriends and girlfriends and husbands and wives and fiancés, and they go out and they enjoy the times and they spend time with each other. And others don't have that luxury. Others, because they didn't get what they expected, they get a little depressed. And others, because of the grieving over loved ones that have spent quality time with them during this time of year, are no longer with them. Others, because they can't be with the one they love. And listen, if you can't be with the one you love, you got to some kind of way find a way to love the one you're with. And sometimes that's not real easy, and sometimes that's not the best thing that somebody could hope for. And poor singles, Christian singles anyway, are challenged the most, those who are saved and sanctified and are single, because sometimes they're all alone, and sometimes it feels like they're Jesus, rejected of all men. And you add to all of this COVID-19, and I think the effects of all these things are exaggerated, are heightened, especially because of the seclusion and because of the sequestering that we're in right now. So most of that is in the natural, most of those feelings. In the spirit, there are those who will always remember and always decree that the reason for the season is Jesus. Ain't that what Kirk Franklin said? You remember? Jesus is the reason for the season. Yes. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, he is. Oh, yes, he is, y'all. And then he goes, I don't need material things. All I need is the love you bring. This holiday, I came to say that Jesus is the only way. And I love it when he steps in and says, because Santa Claus ain't got nothing on this. And we sang that song for years with young people, old people, everybody together. But Jesus is, y'all, the reason for the season. These are songs that people write about Christmas and about what Jesus coming to the earth actually means. And this is the time of year where most of the attention turns to that picture that we all have ingrained in our minds and in our spirits, the picture of that baby that's born in a manger. Another song calls him a holy infant, tender and mild. It's true, the baby seems harmless and was announced as the one who would bring peace. But we can't lock that baby down in a manger. Here we go. We can't see him when he's an adult the same as we saw him when he was a baby, tender, meek, and mild. To many people, Jesus is just some gentle savior, and that's all, just simply a gentle savior. They have him talking in a whisper. They have someone who had never heard a flea. They picture Jesus and portray him as some grown-up baby cooing at the sin of the world. But I've come to give the other side of the story. I want us to see that the baby in the manger came to earth with a greater purpose than being just meek and mild. 1 John 3:8 says, "For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." The devil's works were annihilated by the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. That baby became an aggressive, even belligerent combatant of sin and death. The baby grew up and spoke truth to power and was by all means, if you can take this expression to heart, socially impolite. That's right, the grown Jesus was downright rude at times, displaying a blatant disrespect and disregard for the established political and social and religious norms of that day. He came into the world and the world preferred darkness to light. He went into his own, the Bible says, and his own received him not. Jesus had a fiery disdain for the status quo, for the regular old, for business as usual, for tradition and religion. No one is wrong, y'all, in saying that he came as the Prince of Peace. Don't get me wrong. We want to try to bring balance to this because Isaiah 9:6 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." He is the Prince of Peace amongst us. Well, after he was born, after the fulfillment of Isaiah 9:6, the Bible records the night that he was born like this, Luke 2:11. "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men." That's what many people think about when they think about Jesus and the Christmas season. You see it on the Christmas cards that you receive. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. You used to see it heavily in activity scenes, in public displays, and in parks, and in town squares, in public arenas, in malls, and in schools, and even on the sets of television talk shows. But you don't see it anymore. That's the world in which we live in right now. That leads me to the very point that I feel I need to make on this Christmas day. Jesus coming brings peace, but maybe not the peace that you may expect. The peace that he brings is not an end to conflict and strife. The peace that he brings is not so that we could live comfortably and never have to war or have conflict ever again. We know we're in a war right now. This is a war. We're in a constant battle against sin. And if my wife says at home with clothes, against dirt and grime. But we fight, the Bible says, the good fight of faith. And we're called soldiers. No soldier who engages in a war entangles himself again in the affairs of this life. We realize that we're wrestling not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. That we ought to stand against the wiles of the devil with the complete armor of God on. But I want you to get the picture. Jesus had just selected 12 disciples. And he sent them out to preach. You got to see this. And we got to see this. I think we need to listen to what Jesus has to say after he's all grown up. Jesus is grown. He can speak for himself. So he sends 12 and he says, preach the kingdom of God. Preach that the kingdom has come. How will we know that the kingdom has come? Matthew 10:1. And when he had called his 12 disciples to him, he gave them power over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease. He sends them out to heal the sick and to raise the dead and to proclaim the gospel that the kingdom has come in power. He sent them out in demonstration and power, confirming the word with signs and wonders following. Then in verse 22, he says something to them that may not sound too encouraging for somebody sent to do the will of the Father, sent to do the will of God. Matthew 10:22, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but he who endures to the end will be saved. Now, when you go preaching the kingdom, when you go raising the dead and giving sight to the blind and healing the sick, you're going to be hated. He says, good God Almighty, for his name's sake. But whoever endures the hate, whoever perseveres through the dissidence that you will experience, you will be saved. Hated. Why? For healing the sick? Hated. Why? For raising the dead? Hated. Why? For spreading or sharing the gospel of the kingdom? Yep. Why would folk hate them? Jesus told us, I think we missed it. Why have they been assaulted? What did they do wrong? Nothing. Here's what Jesus says, Matthew 10:22. All men will hate you because of me. They hate them because of their affiliation with Jesus. They followed Jesus. And I think now we begin to see the war that rages as a result of his coming in that manger. All of us who are following him today, all of us who are serving him today, we too are hated. We're hated by men. We're hated by this world. To be the friend of the world is to be the enemy of God. And Jesus came into the world. He came into this world for a specific purpose. And we'll see it in a minute. So he just flat out says to them and to us today, y'all celebrating my coming to earth and call it Christmas, but Matthew 10:34 says, do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. Wait a minute. Somebody may be saying, what happened to peace on earth and goodwill towards men? What happened to he's our Prince of Peace, the sweet baby Jesus of the manger, all holy, meek and mild? He's wilding now. He's brought a sword. He's come to cause division. Now, let's make it clear here that Jesus is not talking about a literal sword. Make it clear. He's not talking about literal bloodshed. We never see anywhere in the Gospels where Jesus has a weapon of war ever. Matter of fact, he told Peter, put up your sword when he came, and he cut off Malchus's ear. We do get a glimpse, though, of what indignation abides in Jesus, that what he harbors, what he's capable of doing, when he made a whip and ran them out of the house of prayer. He said, you have turned my father's house into a den of thieves. And he planted a whip. It took him a while. He had to get the materials. He had to put it together. He made that whip. And then he kicked over the tables of the money changers and he ran them out of the temple. Shoo-pow, sweet little baby Jesus. The zeal of the house of God had consumed him, and he defended it to the hilt. He's not going to stand by and let us abuse the things of our Heavenly Father. But never a sword or a spear actually in his hands. Never did he physically kill anybody. So then what does this sword represent? And I think that's what I want to try to get across. Not many of the wars have been fought throughout history without bloodshed. But those who have been fought throughout history, many of them have been fought over Jesus and the message of the gospel, where blood was shed. Holy wars have taken place on practically every continent, where physically Christians were killing non-Christians in the name of God for some kind of self-defense of the gospel and some kind of desire to want to protect the church against corruption and invaders. And so there have been holy wars, and it's been a challenge for saints over the years, the crusades and the things that happen. As did Jesus say that we should take the sword and use the sword, not that sword. I can't find anywhere in the scriptures where Jesus himself advocates for war or violent bloodshed. So the sword here that he speaks of is not the tool of vengeance and death of our enemies and foes in any kind of way, especially in light of these words from the Master, Matthew 5:44. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father, which is in heaven. You see what he says to do with our enemies? Not kill them, love them. To those who curse us, bless them. To those who persecute us, no, we got to pray for them. You may remember, as I mentioned, that Jesus told Peter when he pulled that sword out, put it back, put it up. That's not what we came to do. My kingdom is not of this world. I could call a legion of angels. I could wipe these folk out. I could speak a word and kill them all. But he says, those who live by the sword shall die by the sword. It's all a matter of semantics, right? It's found in a simple word called peace. Jesus says he has not come to bring peace, but a sword or division. Peace. So the word for peace here is shalom. This is not peace as the absence of violence, but shalom is a peace that comes from wholeness, completeness, completely put together, being unified. So Jesus may be saying that I have not come to bring wholeness or some unifying ministry or message, but just the opposite. He says, I've come to bring division. So Luke 12:51 says, suppose ye that I am come to give peace on earth, I tell you nay, but rather division. In verse 51, another translation, this is what it says. Do you think that I have come to bring peace to the earth? No, I have come to divide people against each other. Now, it's not the intent and the purpose of Jesus to divide people against each other. He came for other purpose, to destroy the works of the devil and to unite people, to reconcile people to God. But because of him, what's in man, we don't know. Man's heart's desperately wicked. But because of him, people will be divided against each other. The sword is symbolic of division. It's used to cut something, cut it in half, to separate things in two. He says that the message of his coming will cause men to have to choose sides. It'll be God's kingdom or the kingdoms of this world. Remember when Herod heard about the coming of the king, the Messiah, a divine king that would be born in Bethlehem, how he was greatly troubled by that baby in the manger. And Herod put out a decree to try to find him and to had every male child two and under killed. The baby was a threat. The baby was a threat to the powers that be. Christ comes and he causes division and derision in the hearts of men. When Joseph and Mary brought Jesus to the temple to be dedicated, remember the old man Simeon had been there and he had been praying, asking God to let him live until he saw this Messiah. And he waited and the Messiah came and he recognized that baby born in the manger was God's Messiah, God's deliverer. So he says in Luke 2:33, the child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, this child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed and a sword will pierce your own soul too. Jesus comes and he says that this child, Simeon says, is going to cause division, the falling, the rising of many in Israel. And that he will be a sign that will be spoken against. And that this division, he would cause angst in the hearts of people. And even a sword to pierce their very own soul. To pierce them right where they live as well. He's prophesying that the child will bring division. But he turned the world upside down or right side up. So at Christmas time, we have to realize that we are not just celebrating a baby in a manger as if he came to make us feel better about ourselves and just to be positive. The baby born in that manger became the most radical and the most hated figure of all time. He didn't come to bring peace. His coming brought a sword. It brought division. It brought division. And it makes people till this day have to take sides, have to make a choice. He came to alter the way the culture was run. He came to challenge illegitimate government rulership. He came to call men out of the power of darkness and into the kingdom of the true and the living God, the kingdom of our Christ. He came for the people that others thought were totally depraved, unsalvageable, incapable of having a real relationship with the Father. He came for the tax collectors and the prostitutes and the adulterers and the thieves and the drunkards and the riffraff and all sorts of people that no one welcomed into their communions and into their fellowship. And he came to offer them communion with God through himself. When he came, he showed the power of love, for greater love had no man than this, that he'll lay down his life for his friends. When Jesus came, nobody knew what agape was, love for nothing in return. Christ came, God so loved the world, he was love personified. He came and did what no prophet could do, no king could do, no judge can do. He came to do what no other man on earth can do. He came to redo what Adam had done. He came to recapitulate the life of Adam and the way that Adam fell, the way that Abraham, the way that Isaac, the way that Jacob, the way that all men that come the way of a woman could not keep the law. Jesus came and he fulfilled the law, kept every jot and every tittle of it to save us. But what does this mean? It means he expects men to replace what's the most important thing in life to us with God himself. When he says this, he came with the purpose of division. He challenges men to love God with everything in them, all their hearts, all their minds, all their soul, and all their strength, to love God, to put God back on the throne of their lives. Jesus has come to dethrone every idol of our hearts. His sword, then, is to sever and to cut us loose from all that has us bound, all that has us distracted from him and his purposes. That's how we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, so that all the things that people have been working for and seeking after for years can simply be added unto us. Now, hold on, because this time of year is one that we believe is all about family. And people try to gather and come together with friends, and they hang out with each other by the tree, under the mistletoe, sipping on that eggnog. You and I know that the ultimate idol, and we know this now, that most people have in their life, the ultimate idol, and I say it all the time, is our family. Many put family above everything, even God. And before God came in the flesh, family was all there was. Paul talked about his heritage and others are from the line of. And Jesus even talked about the Jews and their heritage. And even when they're preaching, the gospel was to the Jew first. They went to Jerusalem after they received power. They went into their own. So there are people who elevate their families and members of their family. So here's what Jesus said, Luke 12:53. From now on, families will split apart, three in favor of me and two against, or two in favor and three against. Father will be divided against son and son against father, mother against daughter, daughter against mother, and mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He says, the three are going to be in favor of me. I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to love Jesus. I'm going to serve Jesus. I'm going to do what Jesus said to do. And two will say, I ain't doing nothing. I don't know who this Jesus is. I'm not ready to receive him. Imagine you got family as the source of your strength and everybody together. Then Jesus comes and somebody in the house puts their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And what that does, it brings division. The sword is the division that is caused when people make Jesus the Lord of their life and others do not. Now, hold on. Here it comes. You got wars and rumors of wars. Matthew 10:36. Your enemies will be right in your own household. If you love your father, listen to what Jesus says, or mother more than you love me, you're not worthy of being mine. Or if you love your son or daughter more than me, you're not worthy of being mine. Did you see that? That's as plain as it can get. He just basically says, man, if you got somebody that you love more than me, you ain't worthy of me. Wow. Now we can say, what manner of man is this? That's something to think about. Steps out into our world and our family, right in the midst of our regularly scheduled encounters and fellowships, and said, if you don't love me more than the members of your immediate family, you cannot be connected to me and to the Father. You're not worthy of me. You have to love me. Now, this has got to be God with us or a maniac. This has got to be God. I believe it was C.S. Lewis that said in Mere Christianity, he's either lunatic, liar, or Lord. But he is worthy of this because he's Emmanuel, which is being interpreted God with us. And we're to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. But keep in mind, when we were without God, we had something that we had to place our faith in, something that was in the place of God, something that we had first when we didn't know him. Whatever yours was, he says when he comes, you got to sever that. You got to cut that off. Family, though, is that thing that we have exalted above all. And I know people that worship their kids, worship their spouses, worship their family name. I know them. I tell them all the time, don't worship that kid. Discipline that kid. Don't worship that spouse. Don't say you can't live without them. Don't decree that. Don't speak that. You can't live without God. And so Jesus is saying, don't get so enamored and so infatuated after you get to know me with people of the earth. I mean more than you, and I'm going to show it to you. Now, don't turn me off now. Please, please just tune me in. Because if God is who the word says he is, if he is creator and supreme, if he is the sustainer of life and the giver of every good thing, if every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from above from the Father of lights, who is neither variable, is neither shadow of turning, if he is the air that we breathe, if he is the song that we sing, if in him we live, move, and have our being, shouldn't he have preeminence over all things? If he's Lord, shouldn't he be master? If he's king, shouldn't he be king? And shouldn't we glorify him? Shouldn't he be greater than any man on earth? He made man and breathed into man the breath of life. You see, the one who created your mother and the one who created your father and the one who created your sister and the one who created your brother deserves a higher place in your life than any of them. He's the reason you have them. God is the reason you have a mother. He's the reason you have a father. He's the reason you have brothers and sisters. He's the reason that you have extended family members. He's the creator of heaven and earth and all things, even man. So we do not recognize God's sovereignty and God's supremacy. We will not give him proper glory. And Jesus is not saying it's Christmas time, so remember me by going out and picking fights with your family members and preach me to them so you can cause division. That's not what he does. No, no, no. We ought to live at peace, the Bible says, with all men, if it be possible. Jesus said, even if you come to the altar and you're worshiping at the altar, you remember that you have ought against someone, you leave your gift there at the altar and you go get it right with them, then come back and worship God. This isn't family conflict just for the sake of conflict. But what he's saying is that because of your relationship with him, your relationship with family and folk of the world will be challenged and be as if it's a war. How many of you right now are warring in the spirit to try to get one of your family members to see that Jesus is real, that Jesus is truly the reason for the season? How many of you have family members and you talk to them? How many of you know religious people and you talk to them and there's no life in them? There's nothing about them that resembles, that reflects the fact that they've been with God. How many of you got up this morning and wanted to worship while others wanted to play? How many of you wanted to pray while others wanted to play? How many of you wanted to listen to gospel music or listen to uplifting music while others wanted to bang, bang and cuss and fuss? How many of you wanted to just have a peaceful time and reflect on the goodness of God while others want to party and want to get drunk and get discombobulated in their spirit through drugs and every other type of licentiousness and wantonness and chambering that there is out there? Five of you, three for me, two against me, three for me, divided between each other and against each other because of me. I see it all the time. I give this testimony when my mother first, when I got became a Christian, my mother was supposedly already a Christian. She was religious at best. My mother was a heavy smoker, heavy drinker, and cussed like a drunken sailor. And was teaching Sunday school. And I remember going to her house and stood at the foot of her bed and I said, Mama, this ain't right. I said something real sweet. I really love my mom. I said something like, you going to hell. And I ducked, you know, if she threw at me and, you know, and get out and I left. And it was a few years later that my mother gave her life totally over to the Lord Jesus Christ and realized that she needed to be right with God, and that would make us one, that would unite us. But for 2+ years, we were divided because of him. And it wasn't self-righteousness on my part. Jesus said, you'll know them by the fruit they bear. It wasn't that. My desire, my concern for my mother was that she lived what she preached. And I wasn't perfect, but I was seeking to do the will of God, and I was walking not after the flesh, but after the spirit. And I just wanted the same for her. But for a fleeting moment, we were divided. I wouldn't go to my mother's house. My kids never spent the night in her home because of Jesus. I can't make it no plainer than that. But I'll never forget the day my mother walked through those double doors on Seaboard Avenue and walked that aisle and embraced me and gave her heart fully over to the Lord and told me, thank you. Thank you. And served him till the day she died. So we live in an hour where our culture has a disdain for the family and for Jesus. The family's being redefined. They have this new family order. I don't know, man. It's a weird day out here. There's nothing that, like God said it ought to be, a husband and a wife, a man and a woman. And it's just a modern family, I think they call it. And people just have a disdain for a true biblical family of a man and a woman and children reproducing after their own kind. And a man is a man and a woman is a woman and so on and so on and so on. And they have a disdain for Jesus. The name Jesus is still the most troubling name in the world. You can say Krishna, Buddha, Allah, Muhammad, all those other things, wherever you are. But the moment you say Jesus, you come under serious attack. Jesus seems to be the thing that either draws people together or pushes people farther apart. The scriptures promise us, even in our families, though, that when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, that our belief has the power to save our old household. And I want to speak that to you. Acts 16:31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved and your house. That God will honor your faith in him when you're sincere, when you're doing alms, when you're living godly, when you're seeking him. He will honor that. Pray for your children. Pray for your family. Pray that God will send, maybe not you, but send somebody. Maybe send this message into your home on a Christmas day today so that Johnny and Will and so that Sheila and so that Deborah and Shaniqua and Shaquanda and so that they can hear from somebody else that God loves them and has a wonderful plan for their life. That the reason for this season is not for them to try to find a safe party to go to tonight, but it's for them to live with God forever when this life is over. It's to secure their home in heaven and to give them power to live in this life right now, soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. We're living an hour right now that the name of Jesus and a walk with Jesus can set an entire family against each other, just like the text says. So family members, we know them. They go away to college. They get involved in cults. They in the neighborhood playing around with witchcraft and voodoo. They get hooked up in false doctrine and secular humanism. They get taught by nihilists and atheists. Agnosticism and subjective relativism becomes the order of their day, the way in which they live their life. They even deny the very gospel that we preach. And they reject to the hilt that Jesus could have come as a man, born in a manger, had died, and rose again. They're over against the gospel. Paul said by the preaching of the cross, he chose to use that to save men. But to the world, it's foolishness. But to those which are saved, being saved, it is the power of God. Isms rule our society. So they can't kill Jesus because he's already come and done his thing now. So they can't kill him. That's why he says they will kill you and think they're doing God a favor. They hated him to the point that they hung him on a cross and killed him. And then text says, he said, they'll hate you because they first hated me. So they won't and can't kill Jesus because he only died once. The point of the man wants to die. But they can kill his reputation in the earth by assaulting you. They try and pervert you, get you off the beaten path. Your enemy, the devil, your adversaries, demonic influence, temptation. That's your enemy. Sin is not your enemy. Temptation leads you to sin. The temptation is your enemy. And Satan is the tempter and the accuser of the brethren. So they try and pervert even the story of the baby in the manger. One, by trying to remove it from public display and trying to take it out of the mindset of even our young people so that they will have no idea what that was all about. Even messing up the scene itself by putting the wise men there when the baby was in the crib rather than 2 years later when they found, you know, just on and on and on. And then two, by distorting the story and making us think that the baby in the manger is all that Jesus ever came to do in the world. And so many people live for Christmas and they live for the baby in the manger. And so in some people's mind, Jesus is a baby in the manger and that he came to bring joy and peace. Yeah, but that we might get gifts and that we might share them with each other only and that we might just have fun and lights and stuff at this time of year. But I came today, and I'm going to finish this, to tell you that the baby in the manger grew up. And that baby became a man. He grew in stature and in favor with God and man. He didn't come just to cause me to spend money and cause you to spend money and to buy gifts for people that you don't like. And I want to come to you to this day and give you this real reason to why Jesus actually came. And there's a few reasons why he came, and I'm going to give them to you in closing. Number one, he came to save the world. He came to save the world. The world had fallen into sin. The world had been encompassed by sin, Adam's sin, and sin fell on us all. And he came to save the world. He came, number two, to reveal the Father. He came to show us the Father. He said to them, he that have seen me have seen the Father. He came to reveal what the Father is like. He was God personified. He was God in the flesh. We beheld him. We saw him. Glory be to God. He came to usher in the kingdom of God. John preached it, but here Jesus brought it. And it wasn't some physical kingdom. It was the invisible kingdom of God. It was in them. He came to do the will of his Father. He said, I've come to do the will of him that sent me. Jesus came to do his will. Remember in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was getting ready to go to the cross and he was praying. He said, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not as I will, but your will be done. He came to do what his Father sent him to do. He only said what his Father said and did what his Father did. He came to do the will of his Father. He came to fulfill the law. He came to fulfill, not destroy the law, but fulfill the law. By the keeping of the law, no flesh can be made perfect. People tried for years to try to live it, to every dot and every tittle. And they tried to jot and tittle, tried to live it. Paul said, if any man could, he could. He was of the tribe of Benjamin, circumcised the eighth day, a Pharisee of the Pharisees. He was righteous concerning the law, blameless concerning zeal. He persecuted the church, but that didn't make him righteous. He said, I count all that but dung, but lost for the knowledge of Christ, that I might know him, that I might obtain for which I have been attained, that I might just keep pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, being conformed into his image from glory to glory. He fulfilled the law. Jesus came and he lived that thing, and he proved to us that we could do it right. How? Through his imputed righteousness. How? Through his grace. He's empowered us. He's done what we couldn't do. Where Adam failed, he recapitulated. He did everything that Adam couldn't do to show you that man has more dominion than any demon in the earth. The man that God sent to the earth, the God-man with no earthly father. That's why Joseph is the stepfather and such a commendable man, in that he walked with Mary through this whole thing because the angel told him that the child that she is with is of the Holy Ghost, and you'll call his name Jesus because he comes to save his people from their sins. But he was born under the law, meaning he had to fulfill the law. It was the fullness of time, and he did it, and he is alive forevermore. And now by grace we are saved through faith in Christ Jesus, not that of ourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works or keeping the law, lest anybody boast about it. So he also next came to seek and to save that which was lost. Them that are whole don't need a physician, but them that are sick. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. All had fallen under the dominion of Satan, the little g god of this world, governments and rulers and kings and princes. But he came to deliver. The marketplace, the government, the education systems, everything had fallen. And Jesus came to seek and to save everything that was lost. Not just man, all that was lost, to reclaim it for his glory. And one day he's going to receive it all. One day he gets the deed to the entire world, the entire universe. One day he comes back and he destroys Satan and his imps, and we reign with him forever and forever. He came to call sinners unto repentance. Glory be to God. Repent and come to God. He came to preach good news. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for the Lord have anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Jesus came both teaching and preaching. Yeah, that little baby wasn't in whispering. That little baby came preaching and teaching. He was like, in the words of Isaiah, one who lifted up his voice like a trumpet and sound the alarm. He warned them, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how many times would I have gathered you as a hen gathers her chicks, but you wouldn't let me. You wouldn't come to me. Jesus wailed. He wept. He wept over them and was moved with compassion because they were like sheep having no shepherd. He came to preach the good news. He came, the Bible said, to destroy the works of the devil. For this purpose was the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. That's why he came. That baby in that manger didn't just come, y'all, to bring peace. He came to bring a sword. He came to bring division. He came to people who have to put up or shut up. He came to distinguish who the children of God are and the children of the devil. John wrote about this and said, them that do righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. But those who commit and continue in sin are of their father the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. But for this purpose, but the Son of God manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. How did he do it? We weren't purchased with corruptible things as in silver and gold, but he came to give his life a ransom. He came to shed his own blood. What can wash away our sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Christ redeemed us. He purchased us with his own blood. Glory be to God. And so now we're free. We're whole. We're washed. The blood of Jesus Christ is efficacious. It's available right now. It never loses it. Power. It reaches to the highest mountain. It flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. He came to atone for our sins, to put us at one mint with God. He is the propitiation for our sins. He's the ultimate expiation for our sins. He's the substitutionary sacrifice, the penal substitutionary sacrifice for our sin. Not only did he bear our sin, take away our sin, but he took the punishment for our sin. God is so just. He doesn't overlook our faults and see our need. God sees our faults and he punishes them. He punished them in the Lord Jesus Christ, in his only Son, while we were sinning. Christ died for us. In his only son, he was wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. And the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with those stripes, we are healed. Christ was hung up for our hang-ups. He bore our sins and griefs on that tree. He was hung up for you. It should have been you that died, but he atoned. He made it possible. The cross serves as a bridge between God and man. And when we cross the cross, the bridge of God to God, we come right, because nobody can come unto the Father except they come by him. So he came to die. That's right, on the cross he died. He died on that cross. He hung his head and he died. When he gave up the ghost, the host of hell thought it was over, but it was just the beginning. He came to die. Nobody took his life. He laid down his life. I'm talking about the baby in the manger. I got caught up here. I'm just talking about the one that came, the one we celebrate Christmas all about, the one that we buy gifts all about, the one that we drink eggnog over, all of that kind of stuff. He didn't come for us just to be happy. He came to bring a sword, because this message is going to cause division and derision if you let it. Somebody's already turned me off. Somebody's already turned me off in the spirit. Somebody's already shut me out. Somebody doesn't want to hear this, but he came to die. He came to die for sinners. He came to die for black folk, white folk, brown folk, red folk, yellow folk. He came to die for all men. Somebody had to die. One man got us into sin and he disobeyed God and he died spiritually that day. The day you eat, he said to Adam, you shall surely die. And Adam died. But when Christ died, good God, the godly for the ungodly, his death wasn't in vain. When he died, God said, in 3 days, I'm going to raise this temple. And he died. He stepped in the grave for 3 days and three nights, like Jonah was in the belly of the fish. When he died, he got up on the third day to fulfill all scriptures and said, all power has been given unto me in heaven and in earth. He died. He came to die. Nobody killed him. He laid down his life. He was born to die. Glory be to God. He came and defeated death. The greatest enemy of man was death. The last enemy of man was death. Man feared death because man feared dying. But once Christ comes and defeats death, glory to God, death doesn't have any more power over us. Death, where's your sting? Grave, where's your victory? Christ Jesus, the first fruit from the dead, is risen, and he's defeated death. He has taken away the fear of death and dying. My friends, to every child of God, let me help you with this. Glory to God. Just this past week, I had the death of one of my daughters in the ministry, a true daughter in the ministry. Glory to God. It's difficult for me right now to even share this message with you, to even talk about death right now. But there's something on the inside of me that's saying death is just the entry into eternity. That when you die, there's no more pain. There's no more suffering. There's no more tears. There's no more sleepless nights. There's no more worry from family and friends. That when you die, it's your doorway into eternity. To die is gain. To live is Christ. So whether I live, it's okay. Whether I die, it's okay. Because I'm not afraid to die, because he's defeated death. And because I know him, I'm going to live with him forever and forever. As Annette Newsom is living with him now forever and forever. And we got that same hope, the blessed hope of the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior. We don't all have to die, because we can all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. Come, Lord Jesus. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus. He's coming real soon, y'all. He's coming. He defeated death so that we can rise with him, so that the dead in Christ can rise first, and then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. He came and defeated death. He came and gave us life, and that more abundantly. He didn't come just so we can live eternally in heaven, but he came so we can live abundantly right now in this life. He came to change the way you think. He came to change the way you believe. He came to give you a new system, a new kingdom, a new principle that will help you to overcome the world. Because this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. We already overcome. As great is he that's in us than he that's in the world. You don't have to lead the projects to be dynamic. You don't have to buy a big house to live good. You don't have to get a job of your dreams to be effective. He'll come in right where you are and make your life better than what it ever was. He'll give you the power to live over everything that comes to try to hinder and to halt you, that'll keep you stuck in a box and try to keep you down. And lastly, my brothers and sisters, he came to bring a sword. As I told you, he came, I hope you can see this, to bring a sword. Remember, Christmas is a declaration of war and
peace in you if the things I just shared with you, if the things that I just told you, if you believe these things, if you heard what I just said, you're going to be hated. You're going to be hated. You're going to be hated. If you believe these things, the world will not receive you. You're going to be hated. If you believe these things, some of your very family members will disown you. Division. You're going to be hated. But the record remains true to this day. I don't care what they say. I don't care who tries to stop me or try to stop you for believing that Christ came to do these things. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth on him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Christmas is a declaration of war and peace. War against those who are opposed to his coming. Peace to those who receive him and take him at his word. He said, my peace I give, not as the world gives, but as I give I unto thee. Put him first. And he promises you peace. Peace of mind. Rest for your soul. Comfort in a time of discomfort. Shelter in the time of a storm. He'll hold you when no one else will. He'll be there for you when no one else understands. The God we serve is real. He's alive. Jesus is real. He's alive. He's making intercession. Put him first. But when you do, expect a fight. They hated him, and they'll hate you. But he says, in that day when they do bring you before magistrates, and they do try to strip you of your faith, and they try to make you denounce him, and they try to ruin his reputation through you, take no thought of what you might say. But at that very hour, the Holy Ghost will give you what to say. This Christmas season, and as any other holiday or season during these times, and I don't just mean COVID times, I just mean perilous times, the day in which we live, these types of messages are antiquated and old fogey, and people would rather watch their favorite comedy program now and turn to football and get this over with. Basketball today, game after game, get this over with. All I'm trying to say is the signs of the times. All I'm trying to say is Christ came. It's called the incarnation. The world calls it Christmas. It wasn't December 25th, but we do know he came. It's not a day that we as Christians should make holy, but it's a time and an event, an advent that we know occurred, and we should let nobody take it away from us. And because he came, we can have peace. But because he came, we will have a sword. There will be division. Trust Jesus. Love him. Follow him. And let him guide you and lead you through every storm of life. Walk through the valley of the shadow of death with him. And don't fear any evil, because he is with you. His rod and his staff is there to comfort you. And this holiday season, this Christmas day, remember why he came. Remember, yes, peace on earth, goodwill towards men.
That's the result of those who follow him and trust him and love him. The fact that he came to offer this to everybody is phenomenal. He's not willing that any perish, but that all come to repentance so that they can experience those things that he promised. So I love you and I thank God for you, and I wouldn't be your friend if I didn't tell you the truth. And the truth of the matter is, we got to stand for God and stop falling for everything. The truth of the matter is, Christ came to save us from sin. Repent, turn away, and turn to him. In Jesus' name, thank you for watching. God bless you.
Amen. We pray you were blessed by this worship experience at the Potter's House. Make sure you share this word with a loved one. And remember the three ways to give. First, through text giving. Just text the word GIVE to 904-601-1695. Follow the prompts and you will receive a confirmation text thanking you for your gifts. The second way is online giving. Just go to tphim.org and select the giving tab and follow the prompts. And also, you can mail in your tithes and offering by sending it to TPHIM at 5119 Normandy Boulevard, Jacksonville, Florida 32205. And lastly, you can give through our Ministry One Church app. Download the app and type in our church name and follow the instructions to give. Once again, we thank you for your continued generosity to the Potter's House. And until next time, remember to share this message and stay connected by following us on Facebook and subscribing to our YouTube channel at TPH Jax. And may God bless you and keep you until our next digital gathering.